Praise the Lord. We'll rise up as we pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for reminding us that the coming of the Lord is very near. And we pray, Lord, every one of us will be ready for that time in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, that your spirit will quicken us, will remind us. Every day as we live, expecting the coming of the Lord, Lord, we pray everything it takes to get us ready and to stay ready. Grant to everyone in Jesus' name. We pray that you bless our study of your word tonight so that this will contribute more to our getting ready. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. We're looking at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Today we're studying verse 9 through verse 12. But for you to get the proper connection, that is to understand what has gone before, the study we have tonight, I'm going to start from verse 3. Open your Bible together with me. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 from verse 3. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he that wants to come, he, the son of perdition, that man of sin, he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things, and now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth, that is, who hinders, who prevents, will let, will hinder, will prevent, until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Verse 9 now, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for that cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned, who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. As you look at those verses, it talks about a day that will come, a time that will come, a period that will come. It's still future. But the mystery of iniquity is already at work, even at this time. From the time of the apostles, they already told us that the spirit of the Antichrist, the attitude of the Antichrist, and the influence of the Antichrist was already at work. And if it was at work about 2,000 years ago, much more today, that attitude and that spirit and that influence of the Antichrist is still at work today. But then it says, the man of sin will eventually appear. That son of perdition will eventually appear, and is called a number of names in the scriptures. He is the Antichrist actually. And so you find that this passage you are looking at today is a prophetic passage, and it contains words of warning for the church of the present day. And men of understanding will take heed, because the word of God says, take heed that no man deceive you. These are days of deception, and men love falsehood, deception, craft, error, rather than the truth, rather than the gospel. And this passage you have read, another passage of the scripture, predicts the coming of the Antichrist. It calls him by various names. Number one, the man of sin. The Antichrist will be the man of sin. And anyone the spirit of the Antichrist is walking in today will be a man of sin, a woman of sin. What does that imply? The man of sin, number one, he'll promote sin. He'll publicize sin. He'll recommend sin. He'll make people to just want to love to sin. Not only that, number two, he'll practice sin himself. He'll do it. Righteousness will not be on his agenda, but sin and evil, iniquity, will be the practice of his life. He promotes sin, man of sin. He practices sin, man of sin. Not only that, he's going to also protect sin. He's going to guard sin. It's like anywhere sinful things are taking place, the man of sin, that's his job, that's his character, that's the characteristic, is going to protect sin. And when you see people today that practice sin and they promote sin, they publicize sin, they also protect sin and they gird so that sinful attitude and sinful actions will continue. That is the spirit of the Antichrist. But then, being the man of sin would lead to another sin, the son of perdition. Have those things in your mind. Sin, on the one hand, perdition, judgment, damnation, condemnation, doom. On the other hand, because he'll be the man of sin, then he will also be the son of perdition. As God's infallible word reveals that the spirit of the Antichrist is ready at work. The mystery of iniquity is ready at work. It tells us then, already now, even now, are there many Antichrists whereby we know it is the last time. Look at 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, we're looking at verse 18. Little children, it is the last time. Once again, I want to remind you, if John, the beloved 2,000 years ago, say it is the last time, then this will be the last hour of the last day of the last time. We're very close to the coming of the Lord. And that's why you find a lot of things around you. And it says, and as you have heard, that the Antichrist shall come, even now are there what? Many Antichrists. What means they're not just a few. It's almost like the devil has distributed all those people having the spirit of the Antichrist, as you said, in every city, almost every community. Because now it says there are many Antichrists whereby we know that it is the last time. I'm going to read verse 19. You know, there's some people that feel that those who have the spirit of the Antichrist, they've never heard about Christ, they never know about Christ. They're strangers to Christ completely. Not really, not really. Some people feel that when that Antichrist comes, he'll know nothing about Christ. And because he knows nothing about Christ, that's why he'll oppose Christ. He contradicts Christ, fight against Christ. But no, look at verse 19. It says, they went out from us. Who are the they? The many Antichrists that are now in the world. It says, don't you ever think they never went to church? Yes, they came to church. They never knew the Lord. Yes, they knew the Lord. They never read the Bible. Yes, they read the Bible. But it says in verse 19, they went out from us, but they were not of us. That is, they were there, but just like water and oil will not mix, they didn't actually accept or receive the real salvation of the Lord. They were there, they heard. They knew it in memory. They knew it in the head. It never got into their heart. The real heart faith that brings us salvation, righteousness, never got into them. That's why it says, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. I'm sure that your short period of the Christian life, you see sometimes some people, they're in the church, and then after that, they leave the church, and then you are wondering. And some of us, young people, were tempted. As if, well, if so-and-so, we call him brother, we call her sister, if so-and-so could leave, what am I doing here? Well, it's because they are not really of us. Before they left, they didn't agree. They didn't accept the totality of the word of God. That's why they left. That's why it's seen over here that they would have continued with us if they were really saved, if they were really sanctified, if they really had this Holy Ghost that is holy and pure. And chase, if they had that Holy Ghost in them, they would have remained. But it says, but they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. I pray that will not happen to you. So we read about this Antichrist and the ones that have the spirit of the Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition, will be a great deceiver. who will deceive the great as well as ordinary people, the high and the low, the mighty and the ignorant, the enlightened and the illiterate, the powerful leaders and average citizens, religious people and secular minds, all will be deceived by him. The activities of the Antichrist will be mysterious, having the hidden power of Satan with deceptive counterfeit miracles, false signs, and lying wonders. That spirit, the mystery of iniquity, is already at work, and many miracle seekers, they are not salvation seekers, miracle seekers, they are not holiness seekers, miracle seekers, they are not will of God seekers, they are not seeking for the will of God, they are not seeking for understanding the word of God, they are not seeking to be obedient to the word of the Lord, just miracle, 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 only healing, only deliverance, and you'll find them in their millions in every country of the world. And it says these miracle seekers, they will be deceived. They are being deceived today. False prophets advertising false miracles are on the increase in many nations of the world. False teachers handling the word of God deceitfully and operating through the hidden things of dishonesty and walking in craftiness are deceiving multitudes in many nations of the world. This is the age of deception. And only commitment to the truth will preserve us from error. I pray God will preserve you from error in Jesus' name. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2. And you'll see what the apostle was telling the Corinthian believers even at that time, long ago. And then you'll see what the Lord is telling us even today in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2. But we have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. You know, if you're going to follow the Lord, this is innate with man. It's almost like part of the Adamic nature. Because since the fall, this deception comes to everybody. But it says, we deliberately will put that aside and will renounce the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully. You wonder, we have only one Bible, and we have one Holy Spirit, and we have the truth, and the truth is central. And the truth is one. And then you find three preachers interpreting the same passage three different ways. And it's because some people are handling the word of God deceitfully. They try to avoid anything that will speak against their sin, against their evil, against their depravity, against their weaknesses. Instead of shaping up and transforming themselves and getting the grace of God to live according to the word of God, they'd rather change the word of God and have their lives changed. And have their hearts changed. Look at chapter 2, 2 Corinthians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 17. It says, for we are not as many which corrupt the word of God. There are people like that, you know. They corrupt the word of God. They misinterpret the word of God. They misapply the word of God. The truth is too pungent for them. And the truth is too uncomfortable for them. And because of that, what they do is to change and twist and misinterpret the word of God. But it says we, by the grace of God, and we can say that here, we are not of those people that corrupt the word of God in Jesus' name. It says, but as of sincerity and as of God, in the sight of God, speak we in Christ. As we look at the study today, the title, you can see it on your outline, Deception and Damnation Through Lying Wonders. So much, even in that topic itself, number one is deception. And where is deception? And that deception continues unchecked. Deception continues unrepented of. Eventually, the result will be damnation. And then, what these people in deception? Because they're lying wonders. They say, you know, I came to this place, I got a child. I came to this place, I got healing. I came to this place, I got deliverance. I got to this place, I got miracle. And they think that that miracle is final. They think that that is the way you measure whether something is true or not. Because of those lying wonders, they stay in deception. And eventually, they end up in damnation. I pray that will not be your lot in Jesus' name. 3 points we're going to consider. Number one, description of the supernatural, lawless wonder workers. The people who try to perform miracles, miracle workers, wonder workers, and yet they're lawless. They're not obedient to the word of God. And they have some kind of supernatural power. Well, Satan has supernatural power too. Number two, deception through seductive lying wonders. Deception through seductive lying wonders. Number three, damnation of seduced lost wanderers. Wanderers like the wandering stars. They're never stable in one place. Today they're here, tomorrow they're in another place. The next week they're in another place. They're wandering about like wandering stars. I pray you'll be stable. I said you'll be stable. You know, sometimes you find some people that last Bible said they were around, and I'm where the Bible said, and I look around, and I say, where is so and so? Where is it? Yes, wandered away. I pray you'll not wander away. You know, sometimes it's because they wander away because I'm looking for a child, and, you know, I'm not married yet. I want to get married. I hear they're giving them husbands in that place. I hear they're giving them wives in that place. They're wandering about. You'll not be a wanderer. But see, those wanderers, they are lost. You'll not be lost in Jesus' name. I come to point number one, the description of supernatural, lawless wonder workers. We're coming to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 9. It tells us very clearly, pointedly, in verse 9, even him, referring to the Antichrist, referring to the man of sin, referring to that son of perdition, whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. Take note of that, that it's not every wonder you see that's coming from God. Not every miracle you see is coming from Christ, coming from the Holy Spirit. It says that lying wonders and lying signs and lying power. It tells us in Matthew chapter 24, you know, some people feel that if you talk, if you say that not every miracle is coming from God, he doesn't believe in miracle. And because he doesn't believe in miracles, that's why he's saying that. Let's look at the words of Jesus himself. Of course, Jesus Christ, because, you know, God approved of him by signs and wonders and miracles. Everywhere he went, whether a synagogue or whether it's in the house or anywhere, when he met people and they met him, there were miracles, and yet he warned us. And he said, it's not every miracle worker that comes from God. We're looking at Matthew chapter 24, verse 24. In Matthew 24, verse 24, for there shall arise false Christ. This Christ talking to us. This Christ warning the church. This Christ saying, be on the alert and be sharp-sighted. Have understanding and be discerning. And don't just take every wonder, every miracle. You know, all these leaflets passing around, and then they advertise all those false miracles. They put the program on one page of the handbill, and then at the back, this one was pregnant after 14 years of marriage, and this one had two babies after 21 years of marriage, and this one had cancer, had tumor, and they, you know, went to India, went everywhere, and there was no result. But when he came to under our tent, on our tabernacle, on our synagogue, see what happened, and then people run there, not understanding that if Satan gives you healing, he also brings bondage, he ties you down. I pray Satan will not tie you down. Look at what Jesus said, for there shall arise false Christ and false prophets, and shall show what kind of signs? Little signs, minimal signs, insignificant signs, what? Great signs and wonders, in so much that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. That is, if it were possible, the people who have been elected and selected, and they come into the kingdom of God and they are saved, all those lying wonders will come as deception. I pray you will not be deceived. What if somebody was sick, and then in your church where salvation is taught, where sanctification is put in place, where the baptism in the Holy Ghost is emphasized, where the totality of the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation is preached. What if you are sick, and then you go to your local pastor, he prays for you, you are not healed? What if then you come to the central church, you come to the combined service, and then let's even assume that the GS prays for you, and yet you are not healed? And then you go to heaven, you die because of that sickness. But somebody say, no, I don't want to die. I'd rather receive a miracle from Satan and stay on earth. Well, allow yourself to be healed by Satan and go to hell? Tell me. No. What if you are going to die? One day we are going to die. Nobody will live here forever except the rapture happens. And so if you are sick, maybe that's the last sickness. Maybe the Lord is saying, pack your load and set your house in order and get ready to go. And if the Lord is saying, you are ready, I'll take you to heaven. You say, praise the Lord, I'm going to heaven. Sudden death and sudden glory. Rather than you are here, you wander here, wander here, wander there, and then they lay those dirty, demonized hands upon your head. And then you say you get healing, and the healing is coming from Satan. I pray it will not happen to you in Jesus' name. Look at verse 25. Behold, I have told you before. The Lord Jesus said, I told you that is going to happen, but it will not happen to you. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 8. Acts of the Apostles chapter 8. You see, there are some people that cannot discern. They cannot tell whether this is coming from God or this is coming from Satan. Let me show you this example. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 9. Acts chapter 8, verse 9. But there was a certain man called, what's the name? Simon. That's the namesake of the Apostle Peter. Simon. What a great name. But look at this. With before time, in the same city, you sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one. That's what he said. You know, the publicity they make, I'm a great prophet. I'm a great miracle worker. I'm a great seer. I can see into the future. I can tell you what you ate 10 years ago. I can tell you which school you went. I have the word of knowledge. I have this. I have that. He gave himself out as some great one to whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is who? The great power of God. No discernment. Because of the things he did to deceive them. They said, this is a great man of God. And he has great power. And says unto him, they had regard. Because that of a long time, he had bewitched them with sorceries. But they never knew it was sorcery. They didn't know it was magic. They didn't know it was hidden power. They didn't know it was of the devil. And then look at even Philip now. But when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Verse 13, then Simon himself did what? Believed also. But don't trust him. I believe. Don't trust him. I accept. Don't trust him. I'm one of you. Don't trust him. Look at this now in verse 13. And it says, and when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and the signs which were done. And Philip never recognized that this man was counterfeit. This one is fake. This one is not of God. And Philip allowed him to be like a partner. It's like he's going to be the assistant of Philip. I pray that such a person will not be your assistant in Jesus' name. But now I want you to look at it from verse 18. And when Simon saw, that's this Simon the sorcerer, when he saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whosoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, I love Peter. I said, I love Peter. You know some people, if somebody is their namesake, they cannot talk straight to that person. We have the same name. They come from the same village. We're from the same tribe. We're speaking the same language. They'll cover them up. There are some people that practice their Christianity with tribalism. They practice their own kind of Christian faith with nationalism. We have the same nation, but Peter of the same name. In our church here, by the grace of God, we don't recognize tribalism. Give me a good amen. Amen. If somebody is living according to the word of God, whether it's coming from the north or coming from the east or coming from anywhere, we accept him, we accept her. But if somebody is even coming from our own village, but you say it's a false prophet, and he says, support me, are we not from the same village? Are we not bearing the same name? Well, we'll not support evil in Jesus' name. Saying, give me money so that I can lay hands on people. And Peter said unto him, verse 20, thy money perish with thee. because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot nor portion in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Philip never discovered that. Well, Peter discovered it because he was an apostle. I want to tell you something, brothers and sisters. There are times when you might be a Philip, an evangelist. You might be a worker in the church. And then there is a Simon the sorcerer. And a fellow is coming in and going out with you. You might be a local pastor in a local church. And, you know, this Simon is going in and out with you. And you never discover that this one has a false spirit. This one has a kind of another spirit, another power. And maybe I come there as the general superintendent and the Lord tells me, this one is phony, this one is fake, this one is counterfeit, this one has another spirit. And I say, brother, you cannot keep this fellow in the church. You cannot keep him among the workers. Get him out of that place. And they will say, but, you know, he's very faithful. We know when he was converted. We baptized him in water, everything else. And I say, no, it's not all right. You know, Philip did not argue with Peter that this man has been following me. If you now get rid of him, it means that people will say, I didn't have discernment. Philip did not worry about that. And so, let the church be one. We're going to be one. I said we're going to be one. If somebody had been, you know, going in and out with you, and then I come and I say, this is not right, this is not right. No argument. We don't argue with each other. We don't say, well, I trust him, I trust her. We're going to be one in Jesus' name. And so that is how they got rid of that Simon, Simon the sorcerer. I pray that we'll get rid of such people from our midst in Jesus' name. The man of sin will demonstrate great signs and wonders and miracles through Satan's power. To demonstrate the power of God, which is genuine, we must be men of God and men of godliness. And such miracles, if it is coming from God, will draw people, attract people to the Lord and to righteousness, to repentance. When somebody is performing real good miracle that's according to the word of God, it will lead people to salvation. It will lead people to want, they will thirst and they will hunger for sanctification, holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. When people receive genuine miracle, they will be so grateful, the Lord has done this for me, and the Lord who has done this for me, I'm going to give my life, everything I've got, I'm going to give to the Lord in gratitude to the Lord. So good miracles and godly miracles and miracles coming from God will lead to salvation, will lead to sanctification, will lead a person to being filled with the Holy Ghost. But you know, all those other kinds of miracles, they are sinning and they are working miracles. They are sinning and they are prophesying. They are sinning and they are doing wonders. They are sinning and they are speaking in tongues. How many people do you know they speak in tongues and speak in tongues and speak in tongues, and yet sin is in their lives, evil in their life, iniquity in their lives? That kind of speaking in tongues is of the devil. Give me a good amen. You know, if a speaking in tongues is coming from God, your life will be pure, your life will be chaste, your life will be wonderful, your life will be righteous. It will be according to the word of the Lord. But the kind of speaking in tongues and working miracles and working wonders and prophesying that keeps you in sin, and you don't have power, you have power to heal the sick, you don't have power over sin, over evil, over fleshly lusts. That's not of God. That's why the Lord is warning us that these people that transform themselves into angels of light and they come to deceive, they will not deceive you. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians 11. I'm reading from verse 13. 2 Corinthians 11. We're looking at verse 13. It says, for such are false apostles. Notice that. It's not everybody you see carrying a card, I'm apostle so-and-so. I'm evangelist so-and-so. No, don't go by what they write on those cards. Anybody can have a card. Anybody can print a card. But they are false apostles. It says over here, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. Transforming themselves. It's not the Holy Ghost transforming them. It's not the grace of God, the faith in Christ transforming them. It is they transforming themselves, appearing to be and promoting themselves, publicizing themselves and saying, I am such and such, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into what? an angel of light. You know that those that go about with dreams, I saw an angel. And he came with light. It wasn't darkness. I know the difference between light and darkness. This one was light. And he told me this. And what they are telling them is false doctrine. I received this from that angel. I saw this in that light. I was enveloped with that light. You see, it says, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great sin if his ministers also be transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. That's damnation. I pray that will not happen to you. I'm looking at Revelation chapter 16, verse 13 and verse 14. Revelation chapter 16, verses 13 and 14. I pray you'll accept the word of God. I pray you believe the word of God. And then you act on the word of God. If you have been, you know, visiting some places, they say it's a prayer meeting. And it doesn't disturb our Monday Bible study. I see, come to the Bible study. It doesn't disturb my, I'm still a member of Deeper Life, of course. And, you know, I come on Sunday and I'm still a worker even in the church. But the time they have that prayer meeting, is it doesn't clash with our programs at all. And then you, because miracles, miracles, miracles. Look at this in Revelation chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 13. Revelation chapter 16, verse 13. And I saw three, what kind of spirits? Unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. Evil spirit, unclean spirit. Look at what it does in verse 14. For they are the spirits of, tell me out loud, of devils doing what? Working miracles which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world. And it says, and to gather them to battle, to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Have you noticed, you know, some of these miracle workers, they'll say, you know, we have kings that come to our fellowship. We have, you know, chiefs and whatever that come to our fellowship. Well, great political leaders, they come to our fellowship. Of course, they'll come. You know, being a university person is different from, you know, being a person that has insight into the things of God. Knowing chemistry does not mean we know Bible. And knowing engineering does not mean we know the Bible. And that we're able to discern. And so when these people see miracle, they don't know the source of the miracle. And they say, we have this figure, we have this great man, we have this great woman, and they are all here. And then because of that, then you run there. Because, you know, kings are there. I'm sitting side by side with the king. I'm sitting side by side with this and that. Look at that verse 14 again. For they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the king of the earth and of the whole world, and it says to gather them to battle against for that great day all of the Lord Almighty. I pray you'll not be deceived in Jesus' name. It tells us the miracles of the Antichrist will be performed after the working of Satan, and will only deceive those who received not the love of the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness, with the end time falling away from the truth. Unwillingness to endure sound doctrine, and a worldwide turning away from the truth and turning onto fables. Antichrist and false prophets can easily deceive the ignorant religious people who are destitute of the truth. Even those who have the rare opportunity and privilege of hearing the truth of the gospel, but do not give them their hearts to Christ in genuine repentance and love for righteousness, will be deceived, because they are ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Look at 2 Timothy. You need to mark this in your Bible. Mark it, because it's very important. 2 Timothy, I'm looking at it from chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. As we look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, I read it to start with verse 1. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. In the last days. And these are the days we're living in now. Times of peril, time of danger, time of deception. Perilous times shall come. What will happen? Then look at verse 7. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Other people coming here, you've been coming for 1 year. Are you born again yet? Come to the knowledge of the truth. The truth that leads to salvation. The truth that leads to sanctification. And the truth that leads to steadfastness in the things of the Lord, in the way of the Lord. But say there are people that ever learn, I never miss Bible study. But do you have what the Bible study is talking about? Saved, sanctified, spirit-filled, and steadfast in the Lord. It says they are ever learning and they are never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. I pray that will not be your lot in Jesus' name. It's important to know that not all miracles of God. The devil and his agents can perform miracles. False prophets and false apostles can perform miracles, signs and lying wonders. The miracles performed by true men of God and true women of God are done in the power of God by men and women who are established in the truth. Such miracles of a moral nature, and they lead the recipients of those miracles to saving truth. The lying wonders of the devil, the lying wonders of the false prophets, the lying wonders of the Antichrist will damn the souls of the men and lead them to perdition. You'll not be a partaker of them. I come to point number two now. Point number two, deception through seductive lying wonders. Seductive lying wonders. You see, those lying wonders, they have a way of attracting somebody and then getting you attached to those false prophets. You need to break that cord and that link with those false prophets so that the deception will not lead to your final doom and damnation. I'm looking at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. It says, with all deceivableness of unrighteousness. What does that mean? That is various kinds of deception. Deceivableness, all kinds of deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish because they received not the love for the truth that they might be saved. They received not the love for the truth. Have you noticed, there are some people who have been in this church. Maybe your parents brought you to the church and then would teach the truth of the word of God here. And then sometimes some of these young people rise up and say, Daddy, Mommy, I don't want to remain in the church anymore. What's the matter with you? What's happening? Because, yes, they know Bible and they teach Bible and they teach holiness. I accept everything, but I don't like the music. Hey. Is it the music that will take you to heaven? We have good music here. I said we have good music here. But they want the kind of music that will make them shake their body. The kind of music that will not affect their feet, not affect their heart, not affect their minds, but affect their body, that they'll be moving here and there and will give liberty to the boys and the girls to hold themselves and do whatever they want to do. They say, yes, they are teaching the Bible. I love when our pastor is preaching. Anytime they're having a program, I will come. But I don't like the music. Therefore, I'm going to such and such a place where the word of God will not be taught. They don't have the love for the truth. And there are some parents that will say, well, that's what my girl, my daughter is deciding. After all, they're still going to church. They have not left God. They're still carrying Bible. They also go for programs. And that, it's not about program. It's the love for the truth, for the word of God. And I pray that none of us will lose that love for the word of God in Jesus' name. With all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, I pray your children will not perish. Because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie. What a dangerous thing when somebody believes a lie. You will not believe a lie. Looking at 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. See what's going to happen in the last days. And that's why you need to take it. You need to take warning so that this will not happen to you in Jesus' name. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, I'm reading verses 1 and 2. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly. See that. Here's the Holy Ghost warning the church. The Holy Ghost warning the believers. And he said, the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith. My joy is, it doesn't say everybody will depart from the faith. I will not depart from the faith. It says some, I'll not be among that some. I said, I'll not be among them. In the latter days, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing, deceiving spirits, and doctrines of devils, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. You know, sometimes you find everyone, people are in the truth, they are tender. The truth softens us. The truth will convict us and makes you tender. And even if you are making a mistake or you are going wrong doctrinally, I will say, brother, look at this passage of the Bible. Look at this part. Look at this part. You are so tender. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know that is the way it is. And then you say, oh, Lord, please forgive me. And then that's over. But the people have their conscience seared with a hot iron. You can show them from Genesis to Revelation and show, look at this and look at this. Old Testament, New Testament. They're seared. They're hardened. They don't accept the word of God. That evil spirit, the lying spirit, has blindfolded them. And when everybody says, praise the Lord for the truth, praise the Lord for the word of God, praise the Lord, because they feel tender, they feel soft, they feel submissive, and they accept the word of God, these ones whose hearts are hardened will not accept. You will not be like that. It says they speak lies in hypocrisy, and they have their hearts and their conscience seared with a hot iron. I'm looking at Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1, we're reading there from verse 6. Galatians chapter 1, reading from verse 6. Here Paul the apostle was talking to these believers, and it surprised him, the attitude of those believers. It surprised him. What? Those believers, what they were not holding. They were not holding to the totality of the word of God. It says in verse 6, chapter 1 of Galatians, it says, I marvel. Paul said, I'm surprised that she are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. Have you sometimes, met one of your old friends and members of the church, and you know, you've not seen him for some time after we decentralized. Now, you know, you are in that district and he's in this group and we are in this other place. And because of that, we have not seen for some time. And then we come together and then you cannot see your friend. What's happening to my friend? And he used to be fervent and zealous and devoted to the truth, to the word of God. And then once, you know, you are praying, oh Lord, help me to see this my brother or to see this my sister. And then lo and behold, maybe a few days after that you see her, say, sister, I was looking for you, I didn't see you. I'm not in that place anymore. That's his church referring to that place anymore. I don't go to that place anymore. What happened? Well, you see, it's still the same gospel, but you know, we don't emphasize all that now. But you know, I tell you that this is what we do now. This is what we do now. In fact, you know, the way we do things now, can I speak in tongues for you? Don't do that for me. Do that for the devil. Praise the Lord. You're surprised. They've gone to another gospel. This gospel that saves. This gospel that sanctifies. You live in it and die in it. And if Jesus comes, you'll be raptured in it in Jesus' name. You will not go to another gospel. Look at verse 7. It says, which is not another. There's no other gospel. It's just one gospel, which is not another. But there be some that trouble you and will pervert, will pollute, will corrupt, will divert, will destroy the real gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we are preached unto you, let him be accursed. Give me a good amen. Amen. And as we said before, so say I now again, if any man, call him an apostle, any man, call him a pastor, any man, call him original deeper life, he was here before, any man, if any man, any man, preach any other gospel unto you than that she have received, tell me the rest, let him be accursed. If it's accursed, can he get to heaven? No. Only those who are blessed of the Lord, blessed with salvation, and blessed with steadfastness, stability, and blessed with sanctification, Not those who are cursed, only those who are blessed by the Lord himself. Those are the people going to heaven, and I've made up my mind, I'm going to that heaven. You'll be there in Jesus' name. Second Timothy, I'm looking at chapter 3. Satan has been a liar, a deceiver, a seducer, a corrupter from the very beginning. His spirits are lying spirits. His miracles and wonders are lying wonders. His interpretations of scripture are deceptive and destructive. His gifts and favors are dangerous and deadly. The man of sin and all men in sin, working miracles, delude and deceive themselves, and they deceive multitudes of their followers. The great deceiver will unscrupulously use every form, every kind of wickedness to deceive those who love miracles more than salvation. That's a problem. They love healing more than holiness. That's a problem. They love success more than sanctification. That's the problem for them. They love deliverance more than doctrine. That's the problem. And they love a prosperity more than purity. That's the problem they have. I pray that you will not be like that in Jesus' name. First things first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then he says, all these other things shall be added unto you. But when we put those other things first, healing first, forget about holiness now. Riches first, forget about righteousness now. And power, prosperity first, forget about purity now. Success is all I want, and forget about sanctification now. When you are like that, you'll be lost. But if you put first thing first, give me salvation, I know the rest will follow. Give me sanctification and holiness, I know the rest will follow. Give me purity of heart, purity of life, I know the rest will follow. And give me doctrine, sound doctrine, that leads a person through this narrow way that leads to heaven. Give that to me. Deliverance will follow after. When you have that right attitude, that's how to get to heaven. But when you change everything around, all you're looking for now, healing, deliverance, success, prosperity, that's very dangerous. I pray you come out of that in Jesus' name. The word of God is warning us, and that's why we're repeating all this. In those who love the world and worldly ease more than heaven and eternal realities will fall for its deception. The son of perdition will draw souls to perdition through their own lusts and uncontrollable desire for deceptive miracles, false signs, and lying wonders. Even today, even at this time, this age, false prophets and heartless deceivers, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, drive souls into damnable error with all deceivableness and of unrighteousness. Those who do not love the truth that says free from sin. The truth that saves. You know, people talk about salvation, but they don't tell us that salvation leads to righteousness. Salvation leads to freedom from sin. Salvation breaks the past hold and habit of sin in your life. But those who don't love that kind of salvation that sets us free from sin, those who reject the truth, and those who abandon the truth that sanctifies, they'll be given over to a reprobate mind and strong delusion. Let's look at Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, verse 28. In Romans chapter 1, verse 28, the word of the Lord assures us and reminds us. It says in Romans chapter 1, verse 28, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God, the holy God, God, the righteous one, God, the final judge, and God, the one who demands holiness and sanctification, because they did not like to retain him in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. And then it talks about the things they do. Look at verse 32. Who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. And since they will not believe the truth, that they might be saved, or since they will not believe the truth, accept the truth, that they might be sanctified, they abandon the state of delusion, believing false doctrine and lies of the Antichrist and Satan. All who live and die in Satan's lies and deception will spend eternity with him in hellfire. That will not be your lot. We'll come to point number three, the damnation of seduced, lost wanderers. Those who are wondering about, brothers and sisters, if you have children, you put your child in a secondary school, you put him here. If he goes to that school regularly, attends all the classes, does all the assignments, does not miss class, and then pays attention, if they're teaching the syllabus, proper syllabus in that school, your child will pass his exam. Give me a good amen. Amen. But you put your child in this school, and then the child will wander from school to school, from A goes to B. And when something happens, one teacher says, why are you doing that? Stand up, sit down. Because of that little thing, that your child will leave school B and go to school C. And then when the principal in the assembly says something, all of you, if you come late to this school again, this is what is going to happen. We're going to be formed in this school. And then your child will leave school C and go to school D. A wandering student like that will never pass any exam. He never completes any assignment with any teacher. And the same thing, you're going to find out a person is working, he works here, and then maybe his supervisor or whatever says, why did you put this here, my friend? This should not be here. And that little correction, he doesn't want to accept that. He says, okay, if that is the case, I resign. And then they resign like that, they go to another place. And then again, there they say, please, over here, this is how we do the work here. And then he says, I don't like this kind of control. Goes to another place, that man will never be rich. It's a wandering stone. It's a rolling stone that never gathers any moss. But if you are a person that is stable, rainy season you are there, dry season you are there, Christmas time you are there, Easter time you are there, all the periods you are there. And when we study the Bible, you are there. When we're talking about faith, about healing, you are there. When we're talking about whatever it is, if we're doing eschatology, you are there. If we're doing salvation, you are there. If we're talking holiness, you are there. You are saying, oh God, all I want is to get to heaven. And they're teaching us everything here, line upon line, precept on precept. It's a stable soul like that will be stable in the Lord, steadfast in the Lord, that will get to heaven. But all these people that are wandering about, they are here today, they are not here again. Then you after they've wandered, then they come back to the church, and then after some time again, maybe one of our preachers stands up and preaches something and says, that's why I went away before, I'm going again. Wandering like that, I pray you'll not be a wanderer. Give me a good amen. Amen. There's damnation for seduced, lost wanderers. You know, sometimes wandering like that becomes a habit. That, you know, you're not just, you don't want to stay in one place. You don't want to be stable there. You pray to the Lord that, Lord, whatever happens, I'm going to stay here. Even if they rebuke me, chastise me, let a righteous man smite me. It will be what? Ointment upon my head. Let's come now to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 12. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 12. It says that they all, some, every one of them, they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. They just delight in unrighteousness. They take pride in righteousness. They enjoy unrighteousness. It tickles them, unrighteousness. It fulfills them, unrighteousness. When you have pleasure in unrighteousness, that's the way to perdition. That's the way to damnation. The damnation of seduced, lost wanderers. We're looking at Psalm 9. Psalm 9, I'm reading here from verse 17. Psalm 9, verse 17. In Psalm 9, verse 17, hear what it says. The wicked shall be turned into where? Tell me out loud. Into hell. And all the nations that forget God. If you didn't have something before, you cannot say you forget. When your teacher is teaching you in the school, and you say, have you forgotten this? That means he told you before. He taught you before. You learned it before. But since now you're forgotten. When it says, the nations that forget God, they knew God before. Like the children of Israel, at the time of Moses, they knew God. They knew the demands of God. They knew the commandments of God. They knew what to do to please the Lord. But now later, they forgot. And it says, those who forget God like that, they'll be turned into hell. In Psalm 52, I read from verse 3. Psalm 52, we're looking at verse 3. Thou lovest evil more than good. That's terrible. Thou lovest lying rather than speaking righteousness. That word sila at the end of that verse means pause and think about that. Meditate on that. That there are people that love falsehood rather than righteousness, and they love evil rather than good. Thou lovest all devouring words, O thou deceitful tongue. God shall likewise destroy thee forever. That's hell. When you say forever, destruction forever, separation from God forever. He shall take thee away and pluck thee out of thy dwelling place and root thee out of the land of the living. Then it says sila again. That means think about that. I pray that will not happen to you. Romans again. Romans chapter 1. Let's come back to this. Romans chapter 1. Reading from verse 28. Romans chapter 1, verse 28. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge. They didn't like to retain God in their knowledge. If anybody comes here and, you know, one day you love that preaching, you love the word of God, you love the Bible study, and then maybe that time you are not thinking about marriage. And then eventually now you are getting much older, you're in your 20s or your early 30s, and now I need to get married, I need to get married. And then when I'll show you the word of God, look at getting married, know the will of God. You do not know the future of any man or the future of any woman. God knows their heart and he knows them. And wait upon the Lord, God will choose for you. At that point of knowing the will of God, that's the time you fall out from the church. I loved the church before I started thinking about marriage, but now look at what they are saying. And because of this, they are saying, I cannot do that. How is it you are praying and God will choose for you? I like to choose for myself. Don't do that. But it's at such a point when your will conflicts with the will of God. When the word of God is revealed, and then you know that this is what to do. And then you say, no, I don't like that. I don't accept that. Look at what it says. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over. He abandoned them. You want to go your way? Go your way. That's terrible. You want to do whatever you want? Okay, go and do it. You want to choose? Anybody, you go and choose. Then after you have chosen, that's terrible. I will not choose for myself. I say I will not choose for myself. God will choose for you in Jesus' name. God is wiser than man. And God is wiser than daddy and mommy. God is wiser than all those matchmakers who are trying to, you know, match you with this and this. Have you thought about brother so-and-so? Have you thought about so-and-so? Why are we doing that? Why don't we allow? Why are you taking the position of God? Because we do not like to retain God in our knowledge. And when God sees that, he gives us over. He will not give me over. I say, he will not give me over. I'm going to be at the center of the will of God all the days of my life in Jesus' name. I transferred that to you. You'll be at the center of the will of God in Jesus' name. God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, haters of God. They hate God eventually. I don't like that. I don't like the doctrine. I don't like the teaching. I don't like the influence. I don't like all their sin. Eventually, they transfer that hatred unto God. Haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to who? To parents. You know, Christian parents that brought you into this world and are saying, this is the way to go, my daughter. That's the way to go, my son. And then you'll believe your unbelieving teachers at school more than your Christian father, your Christian mother. And then some of the boys that, you know, around you,
who know next to nothing. They can't even make, their papers. And those are the people you exalt above your daddy and above your mommy. We must change. I say we must turn around. So by the grace of God, we give chance to daddy and mommy who love the Lord, who know the Lord, who have the Spirit of God to direct us. They will not lead us astray in Jesus' name. But it says, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable or merciful, knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. Not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. The Lord is warning us and telling us that judgment is coming, and we're going to escape the judgment in Jesus' name. In 1 Peter chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 17. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, for the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. Judgment will begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel? Not just hearing the gospel, that obey not the gospel. Not just saying, I was there, I heard it, I learned it, I haven't answered questions. When they ask those questions, it's to obey. Obey not the gospel of God. And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? We're looking at Jude. I'm reading there from verse 4. Jude, reading from verse 4. The word of God is telling us that we need to take heed. You will take heed. You will be wise unto salvation, wise unto sanctification. Verse 4, it says in Jude, verse 4, for there are certain men crept in unawares. Be vigilant in our local churches. Be vigilant in our districts. There are certain men crept in unawares who were before of old ordained to this condemnation of godly men, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. I will therefore put you in remembrance, though ye once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not. They started well. They repented at the beginning. They listened to the Lord at the beginning. They gave themselves to the Lord and to the leadership, to Moses at the beginning. And they passed through the Red Sea. They passed through the wilderness, and then they began to eat the manna coming from heaven, and the pillar of cloud was over there by day, and the pillar of fire by night. They started well, but later they started disagreeing with the word of God, disagreeing with Moses, disagreeing with what the Lord was revealing to them. And it says, afterward, they were destroyed because they believed not anymore. And the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. They left their habitation. When God created those angels, they were holy. God never created an unholy angel, an evil angel. At the time God created, they were holy, they were righteous, they were just wonderful. But then they left that holiness, they left that righteousness, and they left the state in which they were. And now because they backslid and left the state they were, that's why now they are reserved unto judgment of the great day, even as Sodom and Gomorrah. And the cities about them, that's verse 7, in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of what kind of fire? Eternal fire. Likewise also, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. You know, there are people, anytime some people want to disobey the word of God, they first of all begin to find fault with their pastor, their local pastor. After all, pastor so-and-so. After all, leader so-and-so. After all, his wife. And whenever they were talking against the wife of the leader like that, you know what they're driving at? They want to convince you. The reason I don't listen to them anymore, look at his wife. Look at the children. That's why I don't listen to them anymore. They are liars. They're just finding an excuse so that they'll disobey the word of God. God knows your heart. I pray that will change in Jesus' name. That's why I said they speak evil of dignities. Nobody has honor before them anymore. Nobody has dominion, authority before them anymore. It says, yet Michael, the archangel, in verse 9, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses and does not bring against him a really an accusation, and said, the Lord rebuke thee. But these speak evil of those things which they know not. But what they know naturally as brute beasts in those things, they corrupt themselves. It's not even Satan corrupting them now, they corrupt themselves. And I say, look at all the possibilities of corruption today. On the internet, corruption is there. On our television, corruption is there. And in those pornographic magazines, pollution is there. Defilement is there. And these people corrupt themselves. I pray God will cleanse us. I pray God will purge us. And all this self-corruption and self-defilement, God will take away from our lives in Jesus' name. Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain and run greedily after the error of Balaam for reward and perished against sin of Korah. These are sports in your feast of charity. They say, come to church. They say, celebrate with the people of God. They even go to Holy Communion. Think about that, the Lord's Supper. It says there are sports in your feast of charity. When they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear, clouds they are, without water, carried about of winds, trees whose fruit withered, whose without fruit, twice dead. What does that mean? Twice dead. They were dead in sins and trespasses. Then they were saved. They came alive. Then they went back into that spiritual death again. Twice dead, plucked up by the roots, raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame. Wandering stars. You see that wandering stars wandering about. They're not stable. I pray from today you will be stable. And when those people who want you to be a wanderer, when they come to invite you, come here, come there, say, no, I've done that in the past. No more wandering about. I don't want to be lost. I want to stay where God has put me. You'll stay here in Jesus' name. Wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of thee, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own laws, and their mouths speaketh grace-swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of advantage. What the Lord telling us to do? Look at verse 20. But ye, beloved, any beloved there? I pray God to make you remain as beloved. Ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves. Keep yourselves. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. That eternal life, you'll be there. That heaven, you'll be there. Glory land, where God is preparing his people, you'll be there in Jesus' name. The Lord is coming. The Lord is coming. Our choir reminded us tonight, we ought to be ready. We're going to be ready. Are you going to be ready? Why don't you stand up and tell the Lord, oh Lord, make me ready. Make me ready. I want to stay ready. I want to stay ready. All it takes is just to be saved and not to wander here and there and remain in the salvation the Lord has given us and remain in that church where God has given, where God has brought us. You know that all that we're teaching here, which is salvation, sanctification, holiness, without which no man shall save the Lord, and the power of the Holy Ghost, everything is made available. Why don't you then become stable and steadfast in God and say, Lord, I'm going to serve you to the very end. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer. Open your mouth, tell the Lord, Lord, I will not go astray anymore. All these wandering about, moving here and there, going here and there, oh Lord, enough is enough. Enough is enough. The Lord is coming. The Lord is coming. That's why the Lord is challenging us and is saying, be stable. Be steadfast. Stay where God has put you. He's brought you here to hear the word of God and know the word of God and learn the word of God and have the grace of God to be obedient to the word. Salvation is available. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. What a wonderful privilege you have. And he's giving us that promise of sanctification. Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, he suffered without the gate. Let us go therefore unto him without the gate, and he will sanctify us. Blessed are those who thirst and hunger after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. The Lord is calling you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. That's why I brought you here. You are not here by accident. Appreciate that love. Be grateful to the Lord for that love. And his grace is available. It says, my grace is sufficient for you. You have temptations? Come to the Lord. Trials? Come to the Lord. You have some pressures upon your life? Come to the Lord. You have some challenges in your life? That's why we're here. Your local pastors are there, and by the grace of God, I'm here too. And if we agree together as touching anything that we ask, the Lord will do it for you. You don't need to wander here and there. God is still in the business of performing real miracles, genuine miracles. Miracles that get us nearer and nearer to the Lord. Miracles that don't drive us away from heaven. Good miracles. They're there. They're here. You tell the Lord, oh Lord, help me. I don't want to be a wanderer. Wandering about, wandering stars. I don't want to wander into darkness, wander into confusion. These are the last days. And the Lord is saying, abide in me, and let my word abide in you. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Promise the Lord, O Lord, I will abide, I will abide, I will abide. He will help you. He loves you. He will sustain you. He loves you. If you've done anything wrong, you shouldn't have done, it's a loving God. What a pardoning God, a forgiving God we have. Merciful. Just say, Lord, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have gone that direction. I'm sorry about that. That's all. That's all. What grace we have in the Lord. What mercy we have from the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all his benefits. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities. Who healeth all thy diseases. He says, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. If he will never leave you and never forsake you, why would you leave the Lord? Why would you forsake the Lord? You tell the Lord to you, Lord, I thank you. Bless your name. I shall never leave you, God. I'll never forsake you, God. I'll stay in the grace of God until the very end. The Lord will help you. You will not fall. You will not fail.